Thank you everybody for coming tonight. I appreciate it. I know you guys all have busy schedules and taking your time here. Some of us, you know, had to be here. Thank you, Lee Hill. Some of you have come from far away. Yes, from the West Coast. We have people there. This is a very important meeting. Thank you for coming as well. Just very briefly why I wanted to have this tonight. Really, I selected you guys to come because it's really a networking event for us. That these are people that we work with constantly, our colleagues that we work with on physicians, Dr. Issa's group. So this is really two things. One is to introduce Dr. Zaitis to the community, who I had the pleasure of meeting a couple of weeks ago. And he has some neat stuff that we should talk about. And two is really to introduce you again to Mount Sinai. Mount Sinai has been Steve and my home for the last 27 years. We trained there. We never lost our roots where we came from, and we continue to use the hospital today. And I think, you know, being what's going on in Broward County and where we are, obviously nobody here is a employed physician from Memorial. So, you know, I know none of us really have allegiance to Memorial, but on the other hand is that Mount Sinai gives us, you know, a lot of alternatives outside of our community that is really not that far away. So I know I send my patients there. And you know, Steve Sunnerites, the CEO, has been our friend for the last 27 years, and that's how long we go back. So it's really been a great relationship, and you know, and I think that you guys should also hear how easy it is for us to send our patients down there. And Charlene, hi Charlene, we'll talk about that as well. How long do I know you already? Also, at least that long?
27 years.
From Miami Heart, but then we can't say, well, they own Heart, so it's okay. Now it's going to be the Four Seasons.
No, Ritz-Carlton.
The Ritz-Carlton, okay. So just quickly, before Dr. Zaitis introduces himself, what I'm going to do is why don't we just start around the room and just introduce each other. So everybody, I know not everybody knows each other, so why don't we start with you, Wes. And just tell us what you do, so they know.
Hi, I'm Wes Mayan. I'm a cardiac electrophysiologist in our practice here in South Broward. I work mostly out of Memorial. Been here 5 years.
Mitch Cohen, also a cardiac electrophysiologist, been in South Florida for 20 years, also trained at UM, and I've had privileges from Kendall up to...
Didn't you train at South Florida Cardiology Association?
I was getting there. from Kendall all the way up to University Hospital, about 20 hospitals in South Florida. I've had privileges in working there. And my first years out, I did work for a company called South Florida Cardiology.
AKA Lee Bell, for those who don't know.
I'm Jason Rodriguez. I'm a pulmonologist, and essentially have my practice here in my clients.
I'm David Bryce, I'm the practice minister for Dr. Rodriguez.
Ryan Battle, I'm the administrative officer for radiology at the Miami VA, and I'm prepared to sign up.
Alicia,
coaches work, please.
Luis Dami, interventional cardiologist, doing stenting, towers, the mitral plate now, working at the Memorial Regional Hospital. I've been here for 16 years, and I know the work is still in this day.
I'm Simon Velez, family medicine, and I'm
working
with primary doctors at Elite.
Schaefer, internal medicine of the Health Development Group in Miami Beach.
Natalie
King, family practice. I've been with Elite Health about 10 years now, and I just joined the Miami Beach and the Elite office.
So we'll go clockwise. Michelle
Morrison, internal medicine.
Nicole Foster, Dr. Morrison's physician assistant.
Charlene Welker, Senior Vice President of Specialty Surgery Services at MyMitch.
Remember you a long time ago, too.
27 years?
Yeah.
My name's Audra Harding. I'm the practice administrator for Dr. Moises Issa and Dr. Roberta Fernandez-Litt, primary care physician. I'm Sharon Sabaita. I'm one of the nurse practitioners for Dr. Issa.
My name's Kiki, or short for Pedro. I studied at Dominican Republic in medicine, and I work for PCP of Hollywood, managing a couple of the offices and seeing day-to-day things, and glad to meet you all.
Mm-hmm. I am Steve Sonny Marshall, President and CEO of Mount Sinai, and nice to meet you all, and I want to thank Dr. Kirschbaum for arranging, making this all possible.
Alex Mendez, Executive Vice President of Mount Sinai.
Dr. Steven Schnarr, Elite Health.
Danielle Owen. I'm proud to be the family medicine physician at Elite Health in Miami Beach.
And I'm Nima Brennan. I'm an internist from St. Pete, Tampa area, and I'm an interviewee for the Sarasota office of Elite Health.
All right. With that being said, Steve, why don't you introduce yourself and tell them all about you. And one last name, Jennifer, thank you so much for putting this all together. You worked very hard and we really appreciate it.
Absolutely. I hope you all enjoy.
Good job, Jennifer.
It's
a pleasure. Great. So my name is Steve Zaitis. I'm the incoming chief of cardiac surgery at Sinai. And so really, won't take too much of the time in terms of lecturing, but just want to talk about a little bit of the aortic surgery that we do, and also want to touch base on the surgical team at Sinai, touch base on what sort of services we can provide, and the rest of the surgeons and the team at Sinai. We're very proud and very excited going forward. I trained at Columbia Presbyterian, originally from New York, Long Island. And I was at Morristown Memorial Hospital for 8 years in private practice. Pretty active there and did a lot of the minimally invasive valves, but also one of the specialties and one of sort of my niches was aortic surgery, and I'm really looking to grow that at Sinai in partnership with the Marfan's Foundation and other centers, and really looking around the room, both on the medicine and the cardiology, on the pulmonology and EP side. If there are patients with aneurysms, really we would provide, an aortic registry to follow patients, and it may be something of interest and, complementary to, obviously you're following and managing patients, but when you see aneurysms, things to think about, things to refer, just because you said doesn't mean that, they're at surgical, threshold, but really something to, provide in terms of service to patients. We'll go over specifically what that benefit would be. So just go about aortic innovations, touching base on the aortic root, we'll touch, which is really an open operation, but there has been some things over the last 10 years that really changed the management there a lot. We'll talk about the descending aorta, which is mostly an endovascular procedure and treatment these days. And then touch base on the heart, which is really in between, where it's really a hybrid of both open and endovascular treatment. So thoracic aneurysms, why do we treat them? Just like aneurysms in the belly, there is a danger point that really is precipitous once you get, above 6.0. So based on a lot of history of data for natural history studies, people start really dying of rupture, dissection, or death at 6 centimeters. So that is the impetus for the guidelines where, 5.5 is the cutoff typically for thoracic aneurysms to keep people safe. Now, it gets pretty complicated, and this is why one of the things, in general, I do think it's very helpful to have a surgeon follow some of these patients, particularly above the size of 4.5, because that's a long list here in terms of who needs surgery to keep people safe, and this is based on AHA, ACC, and all the surgical societies and guidelines. So people, all comers of aneurysms of 5.5 centimeters or greater are surgical, patients who need surgery. But if, the cutoff is 5.0, if you have a bicuspid aortic valve, or if you have connective tissue disease, or any family history of patients with thoracic aneurysms, because any of those categories, they're really a more malignant disease process. So one family member with a thoracic aneurysm cuts all the family members down to 5.0 in terms of what the thresholds imply. anyone with a sacral aneurysm, meaning instead of being in the entire aorta, if it's off to the side, you know, really an aneurysm growing and abutting the sidewall, that's concerning. Any sacral aneurysm that is enlarging needs treatment because there's a lot more wall tension based on walls of the pons, et cetera, that would make this a very high risk of rupture. Anyone with a type A dissection, anyone with hematoma, which is we've never recognized before, this is really an entity that has always been the case, but has only been recognized over the last 5 to 10 years. Patients with chronic dissections, people with rapid enlargements, more than 5 millimeters in a year, that is a surgical indication. And then if you're operating for any other reason, the cutoff in a low-risk patient is 4.5. So say you're operating for the aortic valve or operating for bypass, you know, the usual cutoff is 4.5 for concomitant surgery. There are rare instances, so leads low as deets. People who have family members who had a dissection where they know that their aorta was under 5, the cutoff would be 4.5. So these are just some of the nuances where it does, you know, make sense sometimes to have a surgeon see it. 4.5 or greater, I would say, in general, you want to have them see a surgeon. It doesn't mean that they're going to have surgery, but again, just a registry. What we go over is, you know, don't lift more than 50 pounds. The other aerobics are okay. You know, be very strict with your cardiologist and medical doctors about your blood pressure management. You know, not smoking. What are the warning signs of a dissection, right? So this is what patients want to hear about. They also want to be reassured. You know, if they're 4.5, their annual risk of a dissection is 2 or 3%. The risk of surgery is 5%. You know, you can rest okay, but these are the warning signs. And if you have a type A dissection, these are the things to do. This is where to go. And every hour matters. And if you get to the hospital in time, your rates of survival with our current techniques are 90% with a type A dissection. So going on to the aortic root, really from Dr. Bentall, 1968, this was revolutionary. He designed the Bentall procedure that is still done today. Really was quite revolutionary, creating a graft and creating buttons. I don't think I can see my the cursor there, so I don't have a laser pointer, but you can see coronary buttons in the top left where, you know, with a mechanical valve, within a graft, you can create buttons in order to accommodate the coronaries. You have to excise the aortic valve, take out all the aneurysm tissue to keep patients safe, and then re-anastomose the graft applied to the aorta where it's normal. Now, these days, rare for patients to want mechanical valves. Tissue valves generally is what we'll do for replacements for most patients. Of course, you count some about pros and cons, but rare these days for mechanical valves. So it's typically a tissue valve conduit that we'll build, which is in the bottom left-hand corner. So we're actually implanting the tissue graft off the shelf into the aortic graft. And the reason we have to build that is custom fit. You want to say, you want to size the aorta for the aorta, you want to size the valve base of the valve, and that's the procedure that we've used since the 1960s. Now, what is new here? With the Bentall, going back up, we, you know, what Dr. Bentall described is taking out the aortic valve, even if it's completely normal, just because the aneurysm is at the root. And so if the valve is structurally normal, that is very different from what we do now. So this is really where mitral valve surgery and repair was 5 or 10 years ago. You cut out all the aortic aneurysm tissue, and you see in the upper left. So the patients are safe, the aortic tissue is gone. But then you save the aortic valve. This is a valve-sparing aortic root, really designed by Tyrone David up in Canada, also known as the David procedure. And you're physically sewing the aortic valve into the aortic graft. And really, the aortic valve is a three-dimensional structure. It is a sine curve. It goes up and down the aortic root. So the commissures get hung up really high. This is two of the recent surgeries I've done where you're re-implanting the tricuspid valve. And when it looks like that, really no reason to, you know, take out an aortic valve. This is an aortic valve which has a lot of durability. So in the bottom right, you'll see the sine curve. This is what a David procedure looks like. On the inside, you're sewing the valve up and down, hanging the commissures up high. The nadir of the leaflets are below the level of coronaries. And so if there is valve prolapse, similar to mitral valve repair, instead of a ring, the aortic graft is the ring, where you're cinching down the aortic valve to make it collapse. You can see little sutures here. If there's prolapse, I'll place several stay sutures. These are temporary sutures to then walk out the prolapse to the commissure on the right-hand side in order to then make the valves competent. And after a long procedure, this is what you want to see. This is partly the surgeon prank. Really what you want to see is good air coaptation of the valve leaflet. And so these are recent examples. So a long air coaptation, you know, in this example, almost a centimeter of coaptation, and really the sign of prayer, which you want to see. So this is just another one from right before I left in November, and that you know is going to be durable, that's going to be long-standing. Bicuspid valves, a lot of these are patients who are young. They're born with a bicuspid aortic valve. They have a natural predisposition for root aneurysms. So that's why we, drop that cutoff to 5.0. They tend to dissect at smaller sizes as opposed to tri-leaflet valves. Bicuspid valves are completely repairable. That's as long as there's not aortic stenosis. So if they're not aortic, they don't have aortic stenosis, they're in their 40s or 50s, you're really operating for the root. These are spareable valves, and you can perform very durable, repairs. So this is data from Belgium, from Alcori's group. Really, if you look through the graphs, even if they start off with severe AI 3 plus or more, that's quite durable over 10 years. If you look at ones that had the valve, the valve sparing procedure or that plus repair, still very similar curves. If you look at bicuspids and tri-leaflets, also very similar. This is something definitely I would encourage you all to look up. This was just in JACC a month or two ago by Tyrone David, who started this operation. Really a very robust data set. Looking at 20 years of experience, valve sparing, people who had tissue valve conduits and people with mechanical valves, there's a survival advantage. So this is really where mitral valve repair was not very long ago. And so this is, what I would see is the balance of power in deciding. You have a young patient, you have isolated pathology, you have normal leaflets, repair all the way. If you have an older patient, if you have severe leaflet damage, if you have a valve that's quote unquote burnt out, meaning a very dilated annulus well over 32 millimeters, those are things that are going to favor more replacement. But I would say, 80 to 90% these days, is repairable. So what are the other things with root surgery? In the old days, circulatory arrest, with anybody who had any extent of the aneurysm up into the neck, that meant you would cool the patient to 18 degrees, put ice in their head, hope for the best, protect them the best as we can, and sew really fast. So now, really we've designed things to make it much safer. You're going to see little incisions underneath the right clavicle. That's not from a pacemaker they had. That's an extra incision for the use for the heart-lung machine arterial graft that you see there on the left. And what that is we're taking advantage of the natural Y in the innominate artery. So you see the anatomy on the right. The innominate artery comes off and gives off the right subclavian and the right parotid. So if your inflow is from the right axillary artery, what that means is you don't have to stop the circulation. You can place a temporary clamp on the innominate proximal. And what that means is you can flow through that graft up into the head vessel, at least through the right parotid. And 90% or more will have intact cerebral villus, and you'll be perfusing the brain. And so really, instead of going to 18 degrees, 28 degrees is perfectly safe. It really extends the times that we can operate safely and more precisely up in the arch, and it has really changed heart surgery completely. So this is data from the other Mount Sinai, a smaller place up in New York, which showed really axillary surgery being much, safer from a neurologic perspective than survival, as opposed to femoral with circulatory arrest. So really, those are the two, just to mention and to be brief, that really have changed and revolutionized, open surgery. So how about the descending aorta? The descending aorta, this in the past and this now, is a very morbid disease where you need to operate in an open fashion. Why is that? The aorta of the descending and the belly, sorry, right before dinner here, pretty graphic, but this is the incision for thoracoabdominal, and this is not well tolerated, in the 1960s, it's not very well tolerated now. You'd be talking about, going through the ribs to dissect the descending aorta up in the chest and extending that to the belly. Because typically the thoracic involvement in descending is all the way down. So what are the operative rates? If you look at open patients today with the best techniques and the most experienced centers, these are the numbers, which are not, you know, very gratifying at all. 30-day mortality rates of 5 to 20%, paraplegia risks of, you know, an average of 5%, renal failure around 9%. So really, there's got to be an alternative, and luckily there is, and that's endovascular surgery, and that's where the technology's improved tremendously. There's now third-generation thoracic stents implantable through the groin. They've gone from very big size to very small size. We can treat young patients who have aortic transections from the trauma. We can treat patients with aneurysms from, you know, the subclavian on down, and there's now branching. So I'll give you two examples just to hit home some of the points and some of the innovations. The neat part here is every patient's different. And the big part that made this possible is more the imaging as well as the devices. Without the three-dimensional images that we can get today, it would be very difficult to plan what we're talking about. You need to custom fit, you know, these stents within, you know, a half millimeter. And that's possible with all the three-dimensional structures. So this is a patient, 76-year-old, I met him in 2009. He had a hematoma, bruising and descending, which is an obvious thing. We treated it medically for a type B dissection. Once you get a hematoma of the aorta, it's never normal. So this was within 3 years, he blossomed three distinct aneurysms up in the chest. And by the way, one that's also starting to blossom, you know, down below, you know, below the renals. His access, which you see on the right, is excellent. So he's got very good arteries. So if you look at this, you couldn't land a stent up high because it's right on top of the subclavian artery. So the way to make this, you know, a hybrid procedure and really not have to open them is a very small incision over the knee, over top of the left clavicle. You connect the carotid and subclavian artery, so you do a bypass. And that means then that in the head vessels, you really can cover the subclavian because it bypassed. And suddenly now you have landing zone. So this is the CAT scan you see, over 6 centimeters of an aneurysm. So here building from below up high, there's three distinct stents that I've placed to cover all the aneurysms. So this is the device in the middle before it's opened up. We then flowered it open. These are self-deploying devices. You actually see the bypass there on the right, the carotid subclavian bypass. You can open up the stents. And then really, you do have to iron out the connections. This is a balloon specially designed to open this up. This is that same patient where you see the metal of the stent very well close to the aortic wall. You see the aneurysms fully excluded. The downside of stents, you have to follow patients closely. You need to make sure there's no endoleaks. Almost always, they're treated in an endovascular fashion. And really, a major move forward. What are we looking at? We're talking about 1% or 2% mortality. You know, really 1% paraplegia risks with thoracic stents, and this is with extensive coverage, very different from what we showed with open surgery. So how about the arch? That's really in between. There's not really procedures endovascularly now to stent across the three head vessels, but what we're doing is really redesigning things that are making it less morbid for the patient. So these are just three different examples. If the ascending aorta and the arch involved, you have to do a total arch, which is shown on the left. But if the arch vessels are not involved, what you can do is replace the ascending and upper right and then stent across the main portion. And the bottom right is one of the funnest, you know, scenarios to operate on, where if the arch is involved, you can do an open procedure to do bypass to the head vessels, but then in one step, stent across the arch. And so I'll give you an example. This is a 71-year-old. Worked in New Jersey at one of the local medical groups, part of the cleaning staff, you know, part of the fixture for 30 years of the medical practice. Very active smoker for a very long time. Lung cancer treated, did well. CLL treated, did well. Now have terrible back pain. You know, where is this coming from? Had a CAT scan. This middle circle, there should be two circles from the aorta, one from the ascending, one from the descending. There's a middle circle there that doesn't belong. Hard to tell even on the sagittals of a CAT scan, but then this is the three-dimensional, you know, picture. Really leaves nothing, you know, to imagination. You see the septal aneurysm of the arch. That is what's been symptomatic. It's been growing based on CAT scans. It explains the subscapular back pain. But The aneurysm is against, exactly opposite of all the head vessels. Top of that is iliofemoral is a very disease. So how are you going to treat this? You do a carotid subclavian bypass, so at least now there's only two head vessels to deal with. What I did was, off pump, not using the heart-lung machine, placed a graft off the ascending aorta to the other two head vessels. The third vessel is bypassed from the neck. You now have a limb, since his femoral axis is core, and that gives you access in one step to stent across the arm. So a little graphic again, but this is the ascending aorta in the middle. This is the limb of the graft that I'm going to use to deploy the stent. There's head vessels up to the top. What's draped on top of it is the innominate vein. This is the pictures of the stent being deployed intraoperatively. You balloon it to iron out, you know, the connections. You then staple off that extra limb. And this is that patient, you know, just a few months later. So the comparison on the left is pre, post, you have the metal of the stent, you see the set for the aneurysm, which is now dark and excluded. So this is down the pipe, not really ready for prime time. But the best designs for the arcs that are coming down the pipe, and we're hoping to be part of the early investigational protocols, is really a dumbbell device. So if you can seal the ascending, seal the descending, and there's two holes for the innominate and the carotid, that then means you can create snorkels to the two head vessels. Combine that with a carotid bypass that you see with a star in the middle, and you know that is the likely treatment, you know, going forward. Only time will tell, but it's certainly a very exciting, you know, part to see the technology progressing again together with imaging. So for Sinai, you know, and the group, I'm very excited to be part of a great team. Roy Williams has been at Sinai for a long time, has been doing a great job with minimally invasive robotic lobectomies on the thoracic front. He was doing a lot of cardiac in the past, is going to be getting back into cardiac again with minimally invasive valves. Angelo LaPietra is really been our device guru. So in terms of TAVRs, in terms of T-bars and thoracic stents, in terms of pacemakers, in terms of pacemaker explants for infections, been doing a great job with that. And Maurice Moa has been doing great work with BEMAs and really pushing the envelope with arterial grafts for bypass. So really, what we will provide very well, and really I think with a great patient experience, is minimally invasive surgery, so minimally invasive approaches through right vein thoracotomies for mitrals, through a small upper sternotomy for aortic valves, through the mini mitral incision, relatively easy to add a tricuspid valve, plus or minus a maze procedure. An exoma is also very approachable from that side. In terms of the aortic valves, whether an upper sternotomy or the second intercostal space to do minimal invasive surgery, all the aortic work that we touch base about, you know, so the valve sparings, valve repairs, emergencies, certainly we're very happy to do any dissection. So, you know, any time of night, you know, the type A's, please feel free. We're going to be very aggressive with coronary revascularization, you know, with internal mammary use of radials. Structural hearts, we were just approved for the low risk trial with Edwards. Partner 3 that was involved with up north will be starting here. So we can randomize low risk patients for TAVR 1-to-1. So that is certainly something exciting. But of course, the other commercially available devices, so both core valve and the Edwards devices for aortic stenosis, but also the clip devices. Future aortic expansions, you know, coming in the short term, certainly with Roy's robotic experience, robotic LIMAs, we hope, with to an LAD. And then that could definitely be partnered with hybrid approaches for stents for the other vessels. And I think that would really be the best of all worlds, drug-eluting stents for the non-IMA, you know, LAD, but really combining that with the survival advantage of the LIMA. So ECMO, short-term LVADs and RVADs. Longer-term looking at LVADs, meaning for destination, or as a bridge to for a transplant at other institutions that will partner with hybrid mazes, combining them with robotic, you know, left atrial appendage ligation. So I'll end there. Certainly, let's make it informal. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you very much for your time, and you know, look forward to work with you all.